beginning of his kingdom was Babel. Genesis 10:10, the Tower of Babel, the beginning of these systems. The story of Babylon is monumental and of great historical significance. Considering the circumstances of the world today, has been demoted to probably one of the most obscure and insignificant events of our ancient history. This important story is rarely mentioned in modern history books, almost intentionally forgotten. Also, when one hears the name Nimrod, many tend to think of some clumsy oaf, one of the little intelligence. In actuality, the Nimrod of old was a mighty leader, the founder of the first great empire of post-flood civilization, the Kingdom of Babylon. The flood of Noah devastated the world Noah once lived in. After the waters receded, and Noah and his family left the ark, God commanded the survivors to spread out and fill the earth, Genesis chapter 9 verse 7 KJV. Unfortunately, the people of the day chose not to obey God. Nearly 200 years after the flood, the descendants of Noah began to multiply in great numbers. Noah's close descendants became the patriarch of a great number of families who, eventually, had coalesced into nations. This disbursement would set the stage for the eventual Babylonian Empire and Babylonian religion. Noah's grandson Cush was one of these early patriarchs, the one who became a leader of many. He did not want to follow God's commandment of fill the earth, but strove for the opposite. He wanted to bring all of the people together. He began to unite everyone into one huge nation, thus beginning the unification movement, all centered at the Tower of Babel. The Bible gives us little information about Cush, Nimrod, and the tower itself. As we read in Genesis chapter 10 verse 8, Cush was the father of Nimrod, and that's about all. Even though the Bible doesn't give us much more about their individual lives, we do learn from other ancient texts that Cush and Nimrod would become legendary throughout the secular pagan world. The Bible does, however, tell us about the beginning of this apostasy at the Tower of Babel, the major rebellion against God and his commandments. And the whole earth was of one language and of one speech. They found a plain in the land of Shinar, and they dwelt there, and they said, "Go to, let us build us a city and a tower, whose top may reach unto heaven, and let us make us a name, lest we be scattered abroad upon the face of the whole earth." Genesis 11:1-4, KJV. As we'll discover in Giants of Scripture, the people of the post-flood era began to pursue the same ideological ideas as their ancestors did before the flood. They wanted to find ways to make a name for themselves. These pride-filled people wanted to exemplify themselves, and not God. Once again, they intentionally disobeyed the ways of God and went out on their own. Why? How could these people become so rebellious, so quickly? One reason was that many people still may have recalled stories of how their ancestors had rebelled against God, before the flood, and thought highly of their efforts. Many of these people began to care more about their ancestors than they did about God. They also seemed more concerned for their own lives than society at large. It soon became all about them. And where did they get the fuel for their self-absorbed fire? Cush and Nimrod, of course. The leaders of this movement wanted the people to make sure that if God ever became angry at them again, he would not be able to sweep them away by a flood, as he did earlier. This was a major reason for the building of this tower, a pride-filled rebellion. According to a variety of ancient texts, the people of Babel, under Cush's command, were attempting to build a structure so high that they would never have to worry about any judgment this so-called God might have in store for them. On top of it, they even wanted to be able to climb up this tower, all the way to heaven, and be able to destroy God with their swinging swords. Their own power, at least in their own minds, was in their unity. Their desires for vengeance became so strong that nothing, at least in their minds, was going to stop them, their resolve for freedom. It may be a little hard to understand why these people would deviate from God's righteousness so quickly, but the more we understand how they lived, and the ideological ways they quickly began to follow, the more it may begin to make sense. As always, God had a perfect plan to thwart these rebellious ways, and the Lord came down to see the city and the tower, which the children of men built. And the Lord said, "Behold, the people is one, and they all have one language, and this they began to do, and now nothing will be restrained from them, which they had imagined to do. Go to, let us go down, and there confound their language, that they might not understand one another's speech." So the Lord scattered them abroad from thence upon the face of the whole earth, and they left off to build the city. Therefore the name of it was called Babel, because the Lord did there confound the language of all the earth. And from thence did the Lord scatter them abroad upon the face of all the earth. Genesis 11:5-9, KJV. This is about as far as the Bible goes into it, but what happened around this time would set the stage for the establishment of one of the most influential ploys of power and control in our history. After God confused the people's languages, nobody could really understand anyone else around them, and the construction of the tower came to a grinding halt. Cush, their former leader, was forced to give up this tower-building project, and hung his head in disgrace. The groups of families, nations once united here were now forced to scatter abroad, each nation according to their own languages, just as God intended. Even though they were forced to separate, the people still wanted to retain the unity of thought they learned at the tower, amongst other rebellious ways. As some of these established states form into empires, the people continued the influences and knowledge they acquired from Kush and Nimrod into their own ways of life. Although most people gave up on finishing this Tower of Babel project, some continued on, in the same vicinity, with another endeavor, the completion of a city. No longer did they concentrate on the Tower of Babel, they now had a city, of which they were to finish, a city with a new name, Babylon. The word Babylon simply means confusion, named after the confusion which resulted from God changing the languages of the people there. So, even though Kush had been disgraced here, he would still regain his stature, he kept his high esteem with the people, because of his once powerful position. Kush's son Nimrod also kept his esteem and stature. He would go on to take over the reins of the establishment of the city of Babylon. Through this, Nimrod would amplify the dignity and respect of even the scattered people around him. He would take this entire tower-building rebellion of Kush one step further. The Bible only mentions him in a couple of verses, and Kush begat Nimrod. He began to be a mighty one in the earth. He was a mighty hunter before the Lord. And the beginning of his kingdom was Babel and Erech and Akkad and Calneh in the land of Shinar. General 10, 8-10, KJV, also mentioned in Micah chapter 5 verse 1, Nimrod was the first mighty one of the post-flood world. Also known as the subduer of leopards, he earned his fame through conquering large wild animals. He was very strong, a giant in both names and in stature. Eventually, after conquering all the dangerous animals around him, he turned his powerful sights towards conquering people. Eventually, Nimrod began the first empire of the post-flood world, the Assyrian-Babylonian Empire. Nimrod brought the original grandeur of the tower-building project into his new political system of governmental rule. And, on top of it, he used theologies that he and his father had taught into forming a religious system of the same foundation. From these systems of politics and religion, his authority and control over people was about to take hold, on a grand scale. Kush and Nimrod were even known for their ability to channel, or communicate with those of the spiritual world. In some schools of thought, the spirits they communicated with were actually considered the dead spirits of their antediluvian ancestors. Regardless, from these acts of communication, the two were able to acquire a great deal of occult knowledge, which allowed them the ability to accomplish such great feats as the construction of the tower. Just as their pre-flood ancestors did, Nimrod and Kush were also able to make a name for themselves. In fact, the scattered people of their era began to admire them and their positions, so much that they started to revere them as gods. Kush and Nimrod became so popular their likenesses were incorporated into many facets of empirical culture since then. Kush, for example, also became known as Thoth, Hermes, and Mercury. Nimrod came to be known under the name Jupiter, Osiris, etc. The Bible may even equate them to gods such as Baal and Merodach, in Judges 6:25-8, Jeremiah chapter 50 verse 2. In the end, the religious foundation of monotheism, there is one and only one God, was about to be challenged. So, once again, God engaged in a plan to upstart this new system of apostate religious beliefs. We'll see what happened next in Origins of Babylon, Part 2.